This is Dr. Norman Thomas. Welcome to today's edition of New Life TV by way of New Life Church International.
God, I'm on my knees again. God, I'm begging, please again. I need you. Oh, I need you. Walking down this desert road, water for my thirsty soul. I need you. Oh, God, I need you. Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. It's like a sound of symphony to my ears. It's like holy water on my skin. Dead man walking, a slave to sin. I want to know about being born again. I need you. Oh God, I need you. So take me to the riverside. Take me under baptism. baptized. I need you. Oh God, I need you. Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. It's like a sound of symphony to my ears. It's like holy water on my skin. On my skin. On my skin. Your grace, God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me wanna change. Lord, I wanna abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me wanna change. I don't wanna abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me wanna change. I don't wanna abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me wanna change. Your forgiveness. It's like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. It's like a sound of symphonies in my ears. It's like holy water on my skin. On my skin. It's like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. It's like a sound of symphony to my ears. It's like holy water on my skin. It's like holy water on my skin.
In John 3:16, the Bible says that God so loved the world that he gave to the world his only begotten Son. This is one of the most powerful times of the year when people's minds and their hearts are on giving. Giving is one of the most powerful forces in the universe. It will literally transform you as an individual as you surrender to this power of giving. Your giving should be motivated the same way, by your love for humanity. Let your love guide you in your giving this Christmas season. So look around you. Everywhere is an opportunity to give. Giving is the ultimate of living.
We're looking forward to our next New Life weekend, Saturday, December 19th, and Sunday, December 20th. Join us as we distribute goods to our local community. Bless the children with Dr. Debbie's Give a Child a Book initiative, and fellowship around the Word and worship as we receive communion during our Christmas service. On Sunday, December 20th, our Christmas service will start at 9:30 a.m. prior to our community distribution. We are looking forward to seeing you.
Giving is simple and secure. If you'd like to give, just text the word give to our giving number and tap the link. From here, you can give any amount you'd like. Choose what you give to and make it a one-time or recurring gift. It's that simple. For your first time, you'll need to register to complete your gift. After that, you can give again, anytime, anywhere. Just text the word give.
Before we move on with today's message, I want to pay tribute to a very special person. It's my dad. Just a few days ago, my dad went home to heaven. And I know that he is just in bliss. He is rejoicing right now in the presence of the Lord. Before my dad went to heaven, he left a legacy. And the legacy was passion to preach the gospel to as many people as he possibly could. Every opportunity that my dad had to spread the gospel and to teach someone about Christ, he did it. Even as us, his children, two boys and two girls, he and my mom raised from birth, they set us in the living room and taught us the Bible every week, and sometimes several days a week, because it was in him from a very early age until ultimately he experienced over 50 years of ministry. So that legacy lives on today. And that's important for you and I while we're still here to understand that we are performing live our legacy for eternity. What are you doing today? So I want to encourage you to live life to the fullest and make sure that it's about you searching out what it is that God has placed you on this earth to do. I want to thank you for all of the love and the outpouring that you have given to me and my family over these several days as we finally laid the remains of my dad to rest. You have expressed so much love to us, and we're so greatly appreciative. So on behalf of my mother and my brother and my sisters, the Thomas family, we want to say thank you. And we appreciate your kindness so very much. God bless you. Dreaming is one of the most important things that you can do in your life. You were actually born for it. You were designed by God to dream because it engages the imagination. God gave you that imagination so that you could literally see what he says. God has big, big plans for you. He's got big things that he desires for you to do. But nothing can come to you except it first comes through you. So don't let anything and don't let anybody stop you from dreaming. Dream big and dream big on purpose. Welcome back as we get into the Word now. Over the next 3 weeks, we're going to be dealing with the spirit of giving. You know, we're in that time of year where we are taught that this is the time that we express our giving to others as we celebrate Christmas. Well, actually, what should happen is we should be about receiving the spirit of giving. You and I, if we're believers, then that's part of who we are. That's part of our nature. That's part of our being. And the reason that is because Christ is in us, right? So if Christ is in us, by virtue of his presence in us, we are recipients of the spirit of giving, and that coming from God the Father. I call God the ultimate giver. And he's the ultimate giver because as it is expressed in John 3:16 and 17, we see an example of what it means to live out the spirit of giving. It says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." And then it goes on in verse 17 to talk about why he gave. And it starts with why he didn't. He did not give his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that through him the world might be saved, or the world might experience salvation, which is peace, wholeness, completeness, prosperity, health. It's everything. It's all inclusive. It's holistic in nature. So God is the ultimate giver, and you're the ultimate beneficiary of God's giving. And so within you is resting a spirit of giving. God so loved. That tells me that the motivation of our giving should always, always be the love of God. Now, that's a lot to be said today, especially in a commercialized world where everything is commercialized, including Christmas, and including sometimes the gifts you buy for others during Christmas. You see, we don't give to compete with others. We don't give to show what we can give. And we don't give in response to somebody's giving of us. We should give because it's coming forth out of a motivation of the love of God in our hearts toward that individual. Sounds like to me that as we operate in the spirit of giving, we should often pray about how we give, especially during this time of year, because your giving can literally become a teachable moment for those that receive the love of God coming forth from you. And if you were to pray about what it is you're actually giving them, then it would exemplify and it would communicate God's love to them in a more impactful way. So I want to challenge you along those lines. My second area of challenge to you is, and I always do this around this time of year, is to challenge people to don't go into debt over this time of year. You know, and a lot of that has to do with expectation. A lot of that has to do with expectation you've created for others to receive from you, and expectation you have of others, so that if you give a certain level of gift, you're expecting them to give back to you on that level or above. That has nothing to do with Christmas. It has nothing to do with the spirit of Christmas. Listen, if you don't have the finances to buy certain things this year, simply do not buy them. Do not go in debt trying to satisfy people's expectations of you in terms of what it is that you should give them. Pray, and I guarantee you that if you pray and ask God, okay, Lord, you know what I have available in terms of Christmas, and you know my heart's desire. So help me, Father. Teach me how to give, and teach me how to be appropriate in my giving. And appropriate, I mean giving from the motivation of the love of God that is on the inside of you already. You already have the spirit of giving already on the inside of you. Draw from that spirit like you would draw water from a well, and watch the wisdom of God come forth into your life where your celebration of Christmas is concerned. And He will show you. He will reveal to you ways in which you can be a blessing to people without you going into debt and spending money trying to pay that debt off until Christmas next year. Don't do that. It's not necessary. You should never put yourself in that sort of position. Don't do that. Now, I want to go back to something here that is in my notes. It's in James chapter 1 and verse 17. Let's go back to expectation. Now, what are you expecting this year in terms of people giving to you? One thing you should do is cut that expectation off. Don't set yourself up to expect certain things from people. Don't do that. You know, why don't you set up to expect from God? He is the ultimate giver. He's the one that can give you to your heart's desire. In James chapter 1 and verse 17, it says, every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, and it comes down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness and no shadow of turning. There's no ambiguity. There's no confusion. God is the giver. He is the giver of good gifts. He is the giver of perfect gifts. And he is ready to distribute those gifts into your life. Now, set yourself up to be a receiver of God's gift in your life. Sure, it's always nice and it's always fun. It's always pleasant when people bring a gift to you. But let's just don't expect it, okay? And when it happens, be grateful and express gratitude and thanksgiving. But don't put that pressure on people to give you something. Even if you give them something, don't do that. Leave all of your expectation for God, and God will give you good and perfect gifts from above. Now, you have to trust him that he knows exactly what it is that you need. And you're going to also have to pray for revelation to know when the gift has come into your life, and take your natural mind off of this thing altogether so you can recognize and operate in complete discernment when God is gifting you. You know, I just believe this is a wonderful, wonderful time of year. It's a time when we really should be experiencing the gift of love, the gift of God's love coming to you and dispensing from you, having fellowship with one another and expressing your love for one another in the love of God. That is the ultimate Christmas experience. Now, let's go to some other things that I want to share with you that Paul talked about when it comes to this whole idea of the spirit of giving. He experienced it with the churches that he founded and became apostle to in the early days of Christianity. You know, when you read the New Testament, the back part of that New Testament, you'll find books that sound like this: Romans, 1st, 2nd Corinthians, you have Colossians, you have Ephesians, you have Philippians. All of these books and more, they are called letters. They are epistles. An epistle is not an apostle. An epistle is a writing, an apostolic writing. It is a letter, basically put. It's a letter written by Paul to the churches in those particular regions. So Ephesians is a letter that Paul wrote to the church at Ephesus. Thessalonians is a letter that Paul wrote to the church at Thessalonica. So forth and so on. Rome and some of the other ones? Corinth, okay, the church at Corinth. So Corinthians is letters, the first letter and the second letter that he wrote to the church at Corinth. And in writing some of these churches, we pick up on Paul's attitude of celebrating the spirit of giving, which we still do today, especially when it involves the church, the body of Christ, contributing to the needs of the poor and contributing to the needs of even the world, where the church is managing the world's needs. Paul celebrated that, and he celebrated it even as he considered them partners with him as they gave into his ministry so that he could advance and promote the gospel. And that's what we do when it's time to give. We recognize and we recite these excerpts in these particular letters because they remind us of what it's supposed to be like in the church when we are endeavoring to advance the gospel to the nations of the world. And so we pattern ourselves after Paul. So today, what that looks like in a typical church, sometimes, not in all churches, but in most churches where they believe in giving and tithing still and the offering, they will go to some of these excerpts in these letters to express, as Paul expressed to the churches, his appreciation for partnership, his appreciation for their participation in giving, so that he could advance. And in some letters he wrote to one church, he referred to the generosity of another church. And all this was done to highlight and to promote the whole concept of the spirit of giving. And I want to read a couple of those. It says in Philippians, and chapter 4 of Philippians, and verse 16. Now, we're just taking an excerpt. And he says, even when I was in Thessalonica, you sent me more than once. Now, I don't say this because I want gift from you. You know what I want to do? I want to go back and I want to look at what this looks like around verse 14. That said, let's just pick up reading there. He says, even so, you have done well to share with me in my present difficulty. So obviously he was going through some challenges in his ministry, and he's commending them for doing well in sharing with him. Now, he's not talking about sharing cookies. He's talking about sharing financially. He says, as you know, you Philippians were the only ones who gave me financial help when I first brought you the good news and then traveled on from Macedonia. He says, in the early days, no other church did this. You were the first. You were the ones that did this. He says, even when I was in Thessalonica, you sent me more than once. In other words, you sent financial help to me more than once to help me to advance the gospel, to take care of my needs, and to take care of my needs in meeting the needs of advancing the gospel. He says, now, I'm not saying this because I want a gift from you. He says, rather, I want you to receive a reward for your kindness. Paul was conscious of the fact that giving, there were several layers to this. He's saying, yes, there's benefit in your giving for me. There's benefit in your giving for the advancement of the assignment that is on my life, that is on the life of this ministry. He says, but there's also benefit for you. There's also reward for you in your giving. He says, I want you to receive a reward for your kindness. I call this the spiritual implications of giving. And this is something that we don't think about during this time of year, especially when we're giving Christmas gifts, that giving a Christmas gift should be no different than you giving into the gospel, than you giving to the church for the advancing of the work of God around the world. In other words, what I'm saying is, it's the same spiritual act. It is the same, it's coming from the same spirit of giving. If you're giving to the church, if you're giving to someone on Christmas, it is the same spirit of giving, and therefore it is the same spiritual act. And because of that, it bears the same spiritual fruit in your life. But you have to acknowledge that. You have to, You have to be aware. You have to be conscious of that in terms of, this is what I'm doing. I am sowing a seed. I am planting seed. I am giving. And every time you give, every time you plant a seed, there's always going to be a return of harvest on your life. He says, yes, thank you. It helped me. He acknowledged that he received benefit of their giving. He says, but also I want you to be reminded of the spiritual implications of your benefit when you give. I want you to receive a reward for your kindness. You see, it would be difficult for me to teach this if I didn't live this. My wife and I, Dr. Debbie and I, we live this way. This is how we live our lives. We live to give, and we give to live. You see? And God has blessed us. He has made sure that we are taken care of. He provides our needs. And not only that, he provides the desires of our hearts. because this is real that we're talking about here. This is not a gimmick. This is not a game. Not to us. We believe it. And because we believe it, we live this way. And because we live this way, we have the conviction to teach you. And so that's why even today, in the middle of a pandemic, we're doing well. When I say we, I mean Dr. Debbie and I and the church. We're doing well in the midst of being dealt the challenge of hurricanes, two hurricanes and a tropical storm and a pandemic. We're still doing well. Even with people not coming into the church physically right now, we're still doing well. Why? Because we have endeavored to teach the gospel, the full gospel, which includes the spirit of giving. And because we have done that, people have continued to do what they know is right to do by way of tithing, by way of giving offering. And they, if you will talk to them, will tell you also they are being blessed as they continue to be dedicated to the fundamental principles of giving. This goes on to say, Paul says in Philippians 4 and verse 18, he says, at the moment, I have all I need. He says, and not only that, I have more. I am generously supplied with the gifts you sent me with Epaphroditus. They are a sweet-smelling sacrifice that is acceptable and pleasing to God. So in this portion of the letter, we can see how God receives our financial gifts into the body of Christ. And there are many ways you can give. You can give to people. You can give to so many different organizations and all this. But I'm talking about the body of Christ. And I'm talking about giving into the body of Christ or into the church at large. And so that's different than giving to a nonprofit organization that may be doing some good things. You should do that, but you shouldn't do that with your tithe. Your tithe belongs in the kingdom of God. And then you can give to the American Heart Association or other organizations like that, but you give them out of your overflow and your abundance. But what belongs to God belongs to God, and you keep that in the body of Christ, in the house of God. And so Paul writes here, he says, they are a sweet-smelling sacrifice that is acceptable and pleasing to God. So that tells me that God finds pleasure in our acts of kindness and giving to others. That as we act out the love of God through giving, that it pleases God when we do. Now I want to read another letter that Paul wrote, and this time it's to the church at Corinth. It's out of the second letter, so that's 2 Corinthians chapter 8. And I'm just going to start reading at verse 1. It says, now I want you to know, dear brothers and sisters, what God in his kindness has done through the churches in Macedonia. Okay, listen to this. He says, they are being tested by many troubles. Sounds like a pandemic, huh? We're being tested. And they are very poor. In other words, it's affected them. It has affected their economic status. But they're also filled with abundant joy, which was overflowed in rich generosity. So these people did not allow what they were experiencing to override the joy of the spirit of giving within them. He says, yes, they were under a lot of pressure by circumstances that had come up on them. But they were also filled with abundant joy, which was overflowed in rich generosity. In verse 3, it says, for I can testify that they not only gave what they could afford, but they gave far more than what they could afford. Now, what does that mean? That means these people going through their troubles had a revelation, they had understanding of the spirit of giving. And in the spirit of giving, you don't give according to your financial statement. You give according to the spirit of God within you and under and by His direction. No one should tell you what to give. Now, the Bible sets this thing up. It tells us about the tithe and it tells us about the offering. But in nowhere in the scriptures do I find that it's proper to tell you a dollar amount that you should give. That's not the spirit of giving. And then when you're approaching Christmas and somebody's trying to set a dollar amount on your giving, you shouldn't even subscribe to that. You should just ignore that. That should have nothing to do with how you give anyone. You give according as God has placed it upon your heart. But Paul says here, they gave not only what they could afford, they gave more than what they could afford, and they did it on their own free will. You hear that? They gave on their own free will. These people were under the guidance of the Spirit of God, and they were living out of the spirit of giving, and it caused them to give more than they could afford. And they did it on their own free will. That's the spirit of giving. That's exactly what that is. Now, you know, there are people that just simply don't care for this kind of teaching. Well, I can't help that. This is the Bible, and I'm reading you the Bible. And my job is not to just give you what you like to hear. My job is to give you the entire counsel of the Word of God. Now, the best thing we can do is just simply yield to the Holy Spirit and allow Him to teach us. Don't let this be something that condemns you if you're not doing it. Let it be something of a measure that you can measure up to and say, okay, that's where the standard is. Then I'm going to aspire. I'm going to reach that standard, and I'm going to begin today. It says, listen to this. They begged us again and again for the privilege of sharing in the gift for the believers in Jerusalem. They even did more than we had hoped, for their action was to give themselves to the Lord and to us, just as God wanted them to do. So he concludes this part. He says, so we have urged Titus, who encouraged your giving in the first place, to return to you and encourage you to finish this ministry of giving. That's where some people are. You know, they started because they have responded to the spirit of giving, and they started this act of giving. And that's personally, that's how I was in the very early days when I understood the whole concept of tithing, and the Holy Spirit was speaking to me about it. So I started tithing and I stopped. You know, why? Because pressure, financial pressure, bills to pay, things to take care of. And then I said, oh man, you know, I'm gonna do it. So I started again and I stopped until I just kept doing that, and I caught the spirit of giving within me, and I have not turned back since. And now, you know, as you know, by definition, the tithe means 10%. Well, we've gone way beyond 10%. And that's on our own free will. That's because when you begin giving, the spirit of giving takes over, and it just graduates you more and more into the will of God for your life. And so we don't give under pressure. We don't let nobody put pressure on us to give. We don't care who it is, and we don't care who else is giving. It don't matter. And you can't shame me into giving in a public setting either. I just won't subscribe to it. I'll just sit down and I'm going to listen to God, and I'm going to receive that instruction from Him, and I'm going to do what He tells me to do. It says here, it says, so Titus, we sent Titus to encourage you to finish this ministry of giving, since you excel in so many ways. You excel in your faith. You are gifted speakers. You know, some of you are so talented in what you do. You are professionals. You're the best in the region. Some of you, the best in the nation at what you do. Your knowledge and your enthusiasm is great, and your love from us. I want you to also excel in this gracious act of giving. He says, don't just be good at everything else but giving. He says, I also want you to excel in giving. And so my encouragement to you today is excel in the spirit of giving. Let Christmas be the time that you say, okay, this is it. I'm going to set myself up for the rest of my life. I'm going to jump into the spirit of giving and let God talk to me all year about how it is I am to be a blessing to those around me. And if you'll just yield and surrender and listen and don't be overwhelmed by the pressure of provision, God will speak to you and you'll have more provision than you need. It says, I am not commanding you to do this, see, but I am testing how genuine your love is by comparing it with the eagerness of other churches. He says, you know the generous grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that by his poverty he could make you rich. You see, and a lot of people don't like that either, but I can't help it. It's in the Bible. I'm just reading the Bible. You see, God wants to prosper you. He wants to increase you because you represent him here on this earth. He wants you to be blessed because he wants to use that to be a gift to humanity. He wants to bless you so you can easily bless others. He don't want you to have to think about it. He just want to be able to prompt you and you respond to that prompting and you be a blessing to others. I'm telling you that right now, as I speak, he is speaking to you. And there are people right now that God will elevate to your consciousness and says, this person or this family is your project for 2021. I'm giving them to you, and I'm going to talk to you about how you are going to be a blessing to them all year long. And if you'll just be quiet for a moment, the Lord will tell you. Now, some of you're not going to be quiet on purpose because you don't want to hear that. But I'm just telling you, it'll just bless your life. It will just bless your life. And so even as I come to a conclusion here today, you can also be a blessing to New Life Church International. You can be a blessing to Norman Thomas Ministries as we're endeavoring to continue to uphold and up and strengthen the ministries that we have around the world with the School of Faith Bible Institute. I've reminded you, and I'll do it again, just in the recent months, we've added several nations to the list of the family of the School of Faith. We launched a school just a few weeks ago in Ghana and the Philippines through our affiliate, Faith Consulate Ministries in Fayetteville, North Carolina, Pastor Ben Simmons and his wife, Joy. They're there and they are hosting the School of Faith at their ministry. And they have launched these schools in the Philippines and in, the Philippines and in Ghana. And then recently, a few months ago, maybe a couple of months ago, we also threw the School of Faith in Belgium, Pastor Greg Goodson, through his affiliation with pastors in Egypt and in North Sudan. We've launched schools in those nations as well. This is exciting. I'm so excited about what God is doing. Even in the midst of a pandemic, nothing stops God and nothing stops you because God is in you. This is Dr. Norman Thomas saying, on behalf of Dr. Debbie and myself, keep walking by faith. In John 3:16, the Bible says that God so loved the world that he gave to the world his only begotten Son. This is one of the most powerful times of the year when people's minds and their hearts are on giving. Giving is one of the most powerful forces in the universe. It will literally transform you as an individual as you surrender to this power of giving. Your giving should be motivated the same way, by your love for humanity. Let your love guide you in your giving this Christmas season. So look around you Everywhere is an opportunity to give. Giving is the ultimate of living.
We're looking forward to our next New Life Weekend, Saturday, December 19th, and Sunday, December 20th. Join us as we distribute goods to our local community. Bless the children with Dr. Debbie's Give a Child a Book initiative, and fellowship around the Word and worship as we receive communion during our Christmas service. On Sunday, December 20th, our Christmas service will start at 9:30 a.m. prior to our community distribution. We are looking forward to seeing you.
See, giving is simple and secure. If you'd like to give, just text the word give to our giving number and tap the link. From here, you can give any amount you'd like. Choose what you give to and make it a one-time or recurring gift. It's that simple. For your first time, you'll need to register to complete your gift. After that, you can give again, anytime, anywhere. Just text the word give.
Thank you for joining us today. Please stay connected to your church by subscribing to our YouTube channel, Instagram, and Facebook. Until next time, keep walking by faith.